on worship. And I want to start by reading Philippians, the fourth chapter. Well, in the fourth chapter, verses 10 through 13, it really ties in to what we'll be talking about today. And it says, well, it's Paul's letter to the church of Philippi. And it says, I'm glad in God, far happier than you would ever guess. Happy that you're again showing such concern for me. Not that you have ever quit praying and thinking about me. You just had no chance to show it. Actually, I do not have a sense of needing anything personally, because I've learned by now to be quite content whatever my circumstances. I'm just as happy with little as with much. With much as with little, I found the recipe for being happy. Whether full or hungry, hands full or hands empty, whatever I have, wherever I am, I can make it through anything, the one who makes me who I am. And that should be all of our testimony today. No matter what circumstance we're in, no matter what state we're in, we have something to be happy about. We have something to be happy about. So this is the day that the Lord has made, and I'm going to rejoice and be happy in it. I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it, aren't you? Will you? Will you at least try? Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for your goodness, for your mercy, and always for your grace. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to come into this place this morning with a heart and a mind to praise you, with a heart and a mind to worship you, God, with a heart and a mind to remember that it is you and in you alone who has made us glad. Lord, we could have been any place else this morning, and we probably could have been no place at all, but you have saw fit to allow us to be in worship, and for that we say thank you, and for that we are happy. So Lord, welcome into this place, welcome into this service, welcome into our lives, that we can return the gratitude, that we can return favor, that we can return joy and thanksgiving to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now let us stand and greet each other in holy love, and let's get ready for worship this morning. Amen.
Oh, 15 is right. People talk like this, I talk like this.
Everybody singing. Everybody's singing now. Why is he? Because we're so happy. Hey, that sounds like why is he? Everybody's singing now. Why? Because we're so happy. If only we could see your face, see you smiling over us. These unseen angels celebrate. The joy is in this place. Well, I could sing unending songs about how you saved my soul. Well, I could dance a thousand miles because of your great love. Oh, I could sing unending songs of how you saved my soul. I could dance a thousand miles because of your great love. Oh, 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 yeah. Oh, well, I could dance a thousand miles because of your great love.
Say that I'm yours.
my Jesus, my Savior, my Jesus, my Savior. Lord, there is none like you. Though my days are once a phrase, the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath. All that I am, never cease to worship you. Oh, shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Lord, majesty, praise you, the King. Mountains bow down, the seas will roar at the sound.
By the fall, cleanse your heart and
on that beautiful, scandalous night she with me. We're atoned by his blood, forever washed white. That beautiful, scandalous night. On the hillside you will be delivered, at the foot of the cross justified. And in your spirit restored, by the river that pours from our blessed Savior's side. At the wonderful, tragic, mysterious tree, on that beautiful, scandalous night, you and me, we're atoned by his blood, forever washed white. That beautiful, scandalous night. At the wonderful, tragic, mysterious tree, on that beautiful, scandalous night, you and me, we're atoned by his blood, forever washed white. That beautiful, scandalous night, on that beautiful, scandalous night, on that beautiful, scandalous
They don't know it. Okay. if you're happy and you know it, praise the Lord. All right, so today I want you to praise the Lord all day because you're happy. Okay. Okay. Because she's happy and she knows it. All right? So if you're happy and you know it, I want you to just be happy all day. And I want you to let someone else know, okay? All right, you can go now to Big House. Go being happy. If you're happy and you know it, go to Big House. Amen. All right. That is hilarious. So how's everybody else? Is anybody else happy? Do you know it? Then clap your hands. All right. Amen. All right, we're gonna get right into worship this morning. I am going to ask. I'm gonna pick somebody. Kimberly,
yeah, okay.
You're going to read our scripture for us this morning? Because she's happy and she knows it.
Psalms 32:1. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and whose spirit is no deceit. Kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night, your hands was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all faithful pray to you, while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will console you with my loving eye on you. Do not be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Many of the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one whose trust in him. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad, you righteous. Sing, all you who are upright in heart. This is the word of the Lord for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. That was Psalm 32, verses 1 through 11. And today I want to talk, and thank you, Kimberly. Today I want to talk about, I just want to be happy. Anybody here just want to be happy? All right, I do. And as you know, we observed Ash Wednesday this past week, and it was a lovely, intimate, and blessed time in the Lord. For those of you who came out last Wednesday night, thank you for being here, and I hope you were blessed as well. And for those of you who may not know, Ash Wednesday, which was last week, it marks the beginning of 40 days of Lent. And we received our ashes on our foreheads as a reminder that we are formed from the dust, and to dust we shall return. I'm going to switch mics here. Hold on. Okay, is that better? All right. However, for the Christian, though, we aren't mere dust. And we should know, in fact, that it was in dust, though, we were formed, and from dust we shall return. For there's a greater revelation in that. We're also one with Christ, and we rest in the blessed assurance that because of our faith profession, we are assured that when we pass from this earthly life, we will experience life and life everlasting. Lent is also a time when we remember how Jesus fasted in the wilderness before beginning his public ministry. And doing so, he allowed himself to become spiritually cleansed in order that he could be free from temptation and distraction and wholly focused on his Father's will. Jesus knew the importance of being totally committed. And that's why he prepared himself for ministry. We can learn a lot from Jesus. One would imagine that having such great assurance should be a joyful time in the life of a Christian. But so often we've been told that Lent seems to call for something a little more serious and reflective and sometimes even somber. Perhaps when we think of how we haven't always been the model Christian, and God knows that's a hard thing to do, and how we fail to always obey to do what's right, say the right things, and love our neighbors and our brothers and our sisters the way we should, it just may indeed cause us to have a God conscience and to be a bit pensive and prayerfully repentant. But as always, when we apply the teachings of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to our own lives, there's always a positive outcome, whether it seems like it or not. No matter how we choose to do in life, if we do it with the Lord in mind or as the head of our lives, whether we choose to acknowledge God or not, we're going to be all right. We're going to be all right. As a matter of fact, tell your neighbor, no matter how you choose, you're going to be all right.
No matter how you choose, you're going to be all right.
Thank you for your obedience. The good news is, although our remorsefulness moves us to repent, we don't have to stay in a constant state of sadness and walking around looking pitiful. We don't have to. We have no longer have to wear ashes and sackcloth and be constantly weighted down by the world of pity and defeat. In other words, we don't have to walk around in constant guilt and shame because somewhere along our Christian journey, we feel that we've fallen and we can't get up. We don't have to live with a dark cloud over our heads, drinking our tears for water and living under constant condemnation because, let's face it, we all mess up. But our God is a merciful God and a good, good Father. On this Communion Sunday, and in fact, as often as we partake of the Holy Communion, we should never, ever forget that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, and our sins are forgiven. Praise God. We should never forget that we have a Savior that is surely with us, even in what seems to be our lowest times and at our lowest points in life. In fact, 1 John 1:9 reminds us that if we confess our sins, the Lord is faithful and he's just to cleanse us and to forgive us from all unrighteousness. We all have a propensity to sin, but we also have a personal Savior that grants us full access to a personal relationship with him. I'm so glad that I know God personally.
Amen.
I'm so glad that he also knows me. You see, our Lord and Savior is the one who has the solution for our broken souls. The Lord has absolutely everything we need, not only to make us better, but to help us to feel better. We need to trust him and allow him to perform his good work in us. And then once we do that, we become the happy Christians we ought to be. Now, I don't know about you, but I want to be happy. Don't you? I want to live a happy life because a happy life is a full life. It isn't measured by its years, but it's measured by its quality. Now, most of you may know a couple of weeks ago, we lost a remarkable young basketball player by the name of Kobe Bryant. And if you don't know that, then I don't know where you've been, okay? But we lost a remarkable basketball player by the name of Kobe Bryant, who played and retired from a team called the Los Angeles Lakers. And we also lost his beautiful daughter, Gianna, and I believe there were 7 other people on a helicopter that crashed, tragically. But this past week, his memorial was televised. And as the world watched, we learned how the life of such a great person seemed to be cut short way too soon. But even as tragic as it was, we also learned that Kobe Bryant lived a life of quality, not only for himself, but for others. Not only was Kobe Bryant a tremendous basketball player, and I don't know much about sports, but I knew that, okay? He was a tremendous basketball player, but he also was a phenomenal humanitarian, a father, and a husband, and an inspiration to the entire world. See, he used his time, and he used his gifts, and he used his talents to help others, and to leave an indelible mark on the world in just 41 years. But what was even more incredible is that his 13-year-old daughter did the same thing. Some people may think it was because he had earned millions playing basketball and sports, and his daughter came by it easily because her father was a superstar athlete, and it came easy to her. And as true as that may seem, or even as true as that may be, the greater fact is that Kobe Bryant found his happiness in bringing joy to others by using what God gave him the ability to do best on and off the court. You see, the reality is that Kobe Bryant had to offer had nothing to do with his length of his years, but what he realized he could do with what he had for the time he had to be blessed with was the quality of his life. Only God knows the time that we have. Only God knows that. And why not spend it finding ways to be happy when the world will have us to do otherwise? You see, tomorrow isn't promised. As a matter of fact, the rest of the day isn't promised. And thank God if we're here. So we have to live each day as if this is our last day. Live each moment as if it's our last moment. I know that sounds kind of dreadful, you know, to even think about. But when you think about it, it makes me happy. And it should make you happy. It should make you happy to know that you have a chance to make a difference in someone's life. It's not just old people who've lived a long time and now they have nothing else to do but try to get their lives together before they breathe their final breath. But it's each and every one of us who have a chance to add to the quality of their lives by adding to the quality of others. You see, I've decided that I don't want only to be happy, but I want to be so happy that my happiness becomes contagious. I want my happiness to be as contagious as the coronavirus. I don't want anybody putting on a mask when they see me. I want them to catch what I've got. I want to be so happy that whoever crosses my path can't help but to be happy also. I want to be happy not because of people, not because of money or material things, but I want to be happy because I know my help comes from the Lord, and it's because it is in Him and Him alone I have strength to face whatever may come my way. I want to be happy because I know without a doubt that the joy of the Lord is my strength, and this joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me, and the world can't take it away. So we look at our sermonic text and we notice that each verse of the 32nd Psalm begins with the word blessed. And if you're paying attention, then you know that each verse begins with blessed. But blessed in this instance could also be translated into the word happy. Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven. Happy are those whom the Lord accuses of having no sin. Well, Pastor, you may be saying to yourselves or even out loud, that sounds all well and good, but how can I experience such happiness for myself? Well, I'm glad you asked. This kind of happiness is found in reconciliation with God and living with a clear conscience. Being reconciled with God once we've gone astray is never impossible. If we choose to allow Him to come into our lives and we choose to live of God as God would want us to live. If we truly want to live for Christ, is not going to always be easy. That's a revelation, isn't it?
Yes.
I'm not going to stand here and try to sell you a bill of goods about being happy. And I'm not going to pretend that just because you're a Christian, everything is going to be hunky-dory and it's going to be a walk through the tulips. It's not going to be like that. In fact, the truth of the matter is, once you decide that you want to put down your worldly ways and sinful habits, it really gets harder. Sure, our lives often feel like one step forward and two steps back. That's why we need to begin not with condemnation, but with encouragement. We begin with a psalm of hope so that we can be reminded that we're not alone as we journey. It gets harder because of temptation and a tendency to do what we've always been comfortable doing. It gets harder because the enemy, Satan, has lost a soldier when we decide to follow Christ. It gets hard because the enemy, Satan, has lost an ally in us once we've decided to follow Jesus, and he's not going to let us go without a fight. There's always going to be something or someone that seems to have been assigned directly to us to be a constant reminder of who we used to be.
Amen.
But I'm here to tell you, just keep your eyes on Jesus. Just keep your eyes on Jesus and he will fight your battles. I'm a living witness. When you feel that you have no fight left, Jesus will fight your battles. And praise God, we serve a God that doesn't keep taking us back to court for sins and crimes we've already been acquitted of. You know, people will do that. People will do that. You've been set free, and here they go again, putting you back on the witness stand. Here they go again, interrogating you for something that God has already wiped clean. But thank God, we don't serve a God like that. That's something to be happy about. You see, the Lord is always extending forgiveness. That's something to praise God for. That's something to shout hallelujah for. That's something to be happy about. I just want to be happy. Don't you?
Yes.
We are all too aware of faults and failures, and because of that we fall into the trap of thinking that those things keep us from living in right relationship with God and with God's people. But I dare you to declare today that you are free and that you have God's permission to be happy. Psalm 32 isn't a song of sorrow, but of hope. Psalm 32 was telling us that reconciliation is possible, that redemption is possible, forgiveness is possible, and cleansing is possible. The psalmist David is living in the new reality that the redeemed of the Lord can now say so. And his reality is that he's a witness to us that joy comes from that place. Joy comes from that place of knowing that it is God who has made us glad. A joy that makes us happy. I know I'm going right down to the end and start calling, but the devil is a liar. Happiness is a joy that comes from deep down in our souls. Are you happy?
Yes.
Are you truly happy?
Yes.
Well, if you're happy, and you know it, clap for me. If you're happy, and you know it, praise the Lord.
Praise
the Lord. If you're happy, and you know it, say, I love the Lord.
I love the Lord.
Now, if you're happy, and you know it, do all three.
Yeah.
God.
Amen.
The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Now, before we go into our word and table, I'm going to change this up just a little bit. We're still going to do it. It's still going to be in Sunday. But I want to extend right now, and I thank you. Thank you. I want to extend, I'm happy about this. Right? I'm happy for this water.
Woo-hoo.
Okay. I want to extend to you, if you're not happy today, a chance to be happy. I want to extend to you Jesus Christ. Because see, when you know who God really is, when you know that he sent his son Jesus for the salvation of our souls and that our sins are wiped away, and we can live in relationship with him, then we can't help but to be happy. It doesn't matter what the world brings. It doesn't matter what people do to us. It doesn't matter what people say to us. Because, see, I'm happy in Jesus. And you too can be happy in Jesus. These kids are happy because, see, they don't have anything to worry about. They don't have anything to worry about. They're depending on mom and dad or grandma or grandpa to supply all their needs. All they have to do, or all they should do, is be obedient. And it's the same with us. God supplies all of our needs. And all we have to do, and all we should do, is be obedient. Yeah, we have responsibilities. Yeah, we have things that we have to take care of. And sometimes it seems like the weight of the world is on our shoulders. But we are here today because God has supplied our needs. And that's something to be happy about. That's something to be happy about. But if you don't know who your Father is, if you don't know who the one who's keeping you, then someone may not be as happy. So today, I want to extend to you a chance to be happy. I want to extend to you a chance not to be happy because I said be happy, but I want to extend to you a chance to be happy in Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, the one who keeps you each and every day. So if you don't know Christ as your Savior today, then the doors of the church are open. The doors of the church are open symbolically to let you know that Jesus rests, rules, and abides in this place, and he rests, rules, and abides in you. And if you decide that today is not your day, or I'm already happy, then share that happiness with someone else today. You be contagious today. You be contagious with happiness today. Amen. Amen. Now let us read our word at the table as we prepare for Holy Communion. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Creator of heaven and earth, and so for your people on earth, and all We praise your name.